let's go to the main content of this live video. And I, yes, so I can now see the presentation, and you can now see me in the small caption at the left bottom corner. And I think my voice is quite clearly audible, and if not, then please ping me, please comment, and I will try to increase my voice. This session is mainly regarding for the Marie Curie Fellowship and the Erasmus Mundus. So I will be talking about the Marie Curie Fellowship. So the contents of this live video are as follows: that our Marie Curie Fellowship, I will be talking about that Marie Curie Fellowship, and then I will talk about the Erasmus Mundus Scholarship, and then I will highlight upon the Euraxis portal. Yeah, thanks, Sheikh Sajjad. Now you can hear my voice. Then I will talk about how one should prepare applications, and then what should you include in the motivation letter, because motivation letter is one of the important aspects of your application when you are going to apply in the European university. The next point is about the Europass CV format, because many universities, they ask about this Europass CV format, and how you should build this Europass CV format. I will also cover this topic in this presentation or the live video. And then the TOEFL and the IELTS, how much are they important? What are the other alternatives that you should look for? And then about the GRE, are they really important for the European universities? And how much financial support are they going to provide? What do they cover? And at last, who can apply? And simultaneously, I will also share some of my experience and the process that I have gone through it. And the applications that I prepared, all these things. So, Marie Curie Fellowship is a well-known, is a prestigious fellowship of Europe, and this fellowship is named after, as you all might know, that it was named after the French and Polish Nobel Prize scientist Marie Curie. This Marie Curie is actually pronounced as EU Marie Sklodowska-Curie Actions. So it is named as MSCA in abbreviation, and the main aspect of this fellowship, Marie Curie Fellowship, is that it supports researchers at all the stages of careers. So this means that it is for the PhD, the postdocs, and those who are research scientists, even those who are even professors, like they spent 20 or 15 years of their life doing research, they can also apply for this funding, for this Marie Curie Fellowship. So the point is that it supports researchers at all stages of careers, and those stages of careers start from like when you finish your master's, and then you are ready to enroll into PhD, then you should look for this Marie Curie fellowship. So we have this fellowship is for the doctorate, for the PhD who want to get PhD from the European universities. Then we have those, we call it as experienced researcher, to those who already qualified the PhD, and they are called as experienced researcher. Then we have highly experienced researcher. So these all kinds of researchers are integrated into this Marie Curie fellowship. One of the important and one of the good points of this Marie Curie fellowship is that there is no such bar on nationality. So any citizen of any country or any from any origin, whether it's from Asia or Africa or Australia or United States, North America, South America, they all are equally eligible to apply for this Marie Curie fellowship. And there is no such bar that you have to be from a specific field, like you can only be from medicine or you can only be from engineering. No, it includes all the disciplines, whether it's engineering, it's science, it's social science, humanities, economic science, etc. So it includes all kinds of disciplines. And so if you have any thought, or if you want to get PhD and if along with the industrial experience training and skill development, then you can apply for this Marie Curie fellowship. This Marie Curie fellowship is unique in the sense that it also supports industrial doctorate. So in this Marie Curie fellowship, we have a consortium, like many universities and industries, they can come together and they can collaborate, and they can establish a consortium, they can select the researchers to give them the doctorate. So it's a kind of a handshake between the academic and the company, academic and the industry. So for example, the project that I belong is a multi-terminal DC offshore grid for wind, DC grid for offshore wind platform. And in this Marie Curie project, we have 5 universities and 6 industry partners. So this gives us the opportunity. So I have a question right now from Haris Ahsan Safari. Is a research publication necessary at master's level in India to apply for PhD in European countries? Surely, Haris, I will answer your question right after finishing this slide. So just wait a few more minutes. So I was talking about the collaboration between academic and the industry. And yes, it's a very good opportunity that you can enroll in a PhD program in an industrial-based project, and then you can simultaneously go along with the industry, for example, like training, like tutorials, like internship and second mentoring this PhD program. And that I also did during my PhD program during the last 3 years, that I have been given the opportunity to go to the industrial partners who are the partners of this consortium. So this is one of the best opportunities for Marie Curie fellowship, that you can simultaneously share your experience as a researcher as well as in an industry. And there is a lot of possibility to gain experience in this Marie Curie fellowship, because you have to travel. This Marie Curie fellowship by the European Union keeps it mandatory that the researcher, they have to travel to another country for internship. So during my Marie Curie Fellowship Program. I traveled to the UK and I did my internship there. Then I traveled to Belgium. I did my internship there. I traveled to one of the companies in Portugal and I did my internship there. So it's a kind of a hands-on experience in industry as well. And this gives you the opportunity to complete training and workshops and lectures and tutorials and many tutorials for your softwares, for some hardware knowledge, to visit some industrial sectors, because we have a separate fund for that. So European Union makes it mandatory that those funds should be utilized for the complete training. So you can ask for the fund. If you have a conference, you can ask for the fund so that you can go and attend the conference. If there is training for some particular software, you can ask for the fund and then you can go and attend the training, because those funds are already given by the European Union to enhance all of your training, your workshop, your lectures, your skills. So it actually makes you concrete so that your employability can be enhanced and your career opportunities can be in a better way. So I will take one question right now from Haris Ahsan Sabzari. Is research publication necessary at master's level in India to apply for PhD in European countries? Surely, Haris, thank you for the question. And yes, it's very good. It's very good if you have a publication either in an international conference or a national conference or even one journal, if you are able to publish. Because now I see that students from many other countries during their masters, even in bachelor, undergraduate, they publish papers. So you should, or one should try to publish papers during the master and the undergraduate by attending, if not possible in journal, because I know that journal requires a lot of work, but if you are able and if you have all those capability, so you can you should try to publish. But that's not mandatory. That will give you an additional point when you are going to apply to any European university. For example, in my master I published two international conference paper, which was an IEEE conference, and that IEEE conference took place in India, in Bhopal. In my undergraduate, me and my friends, we published one national conference. It was just an exposure, but all those things count, and it counts a lot. So you should try to put your work in the form of paper so that the reader can read your work and you can then put those work in the form of CV, and that will surely give you another point when you're going to apply. And especially in the Marie Curie Fellowship, you know, we have a very strong competition in the Marie Curie Fellowship because the number of aspirants, because the number of researchers, they are large in number. So yes, if you can, then you should try. And otherwise, if you have another thing that you can present in the CV, that's also very good. So other question is from Anam Zahra. TOEFL or IELTS, which is the best one to choose along with GMAT? So I suppose Anam, you are trying to go for MBA, because then I think GMAT is mainly required for MBA, yes. Are you able to listen the audio clearly? Can you please ping? Because I'm not sure about the audio quality. So it depends. So it depends upon the TOEFL or the IELTS and the university. For example, if you want to go for the university in Germany, in UK, in Netherlands, in okay, thanks, Haris. In Netherlands, then you should look for the university, because the university gives you all the information regarding the TOEFL and the IELTS. So yes, I have seen that majority of the university, they ask for the TOEFL or IELTS if you are going for the MBA, but we have some exceptions as well in the European university, and they say that if your previous 3 years or 4 years of education was in English, like that is the medium of instruction was in English, then there is no need to go for TOEFL or IELTS. But this should be written, or this should be given in the university website, and they that you need to confirm. Otherwise, you have to go to TOEFL or IELTS. And I think in the European universities, all of them accept TOEFL as well as IELTS as well as Oxford English Test language. So you need to choose between them. So the next slide that I would like to cover is about the Marie Curie Fellowship. So I have given the link about the Marie Curie Fellowship. So all the Marie Curie vacancies, all the Marie Curie positions, you can find through this link which I have shared right now on the slide. So if you go to this link, you will find all the present Marie Curie position. So Marie Curie Fellowship works in this way, that the university who wants to hire researchers for some project, they have to first write the proposal, and then they will submit the proposal to the European Union with the defined tasks, objectives and milestones and the defined topic, and then the European Union, they will accept the proposal. So it's a very competitive proposal. After acceptance only, they will publish the vacancies, and you can find all those vacancies, all the accepted proposals on this link about the Marie Curie Actions. So if you search or if you Google Marie Curie Actions, then you will find the website where you can find all the positions. This Marie Curie Fellowship, it encourages transnational, intersectoral and interdisciplinary mobility. It means that as I said earlier, that there is no such issue of nationality. You can be from anywhere, from any country, any citizen, if you are qualified enough and if you are really eligible to go for that fellowship, then you should apply. And they encourage transnational mobility. That means that a researcher from India, a researcher from China, from Australia, from US, they can apply and they can come to this fellowship. It's also intersectoral and interdisciplinary, in the sense that there are many projects that invites applications from different disciplines, either from mechanical and electrical, then biomedical, then chemical. So we have interdisciplinary and intersectoral mobility. One of the important aspects and important point of this Marie Curie Fellowship is about that the European Union, they are ready to invest more than 6 billion euros till this 2020. So that means that they have lots of projects and lots of calls for applications, lots of proposals. They are ready to finance, and the European universities in partnership with the third countries, for example countries like India, like China, like Japan, like Russia, they can come together, they can collaborate, and they can prepare a proposal and then submit it to the European Union. It is mainly focused on innovation skills. So the main aspect of this Marie Curie Fellowship is to develop the skill, to develop the skill of the researcher, to make them more employable, to make them more skilled. And as I mentioned, that it starts from PhD. So the master, so those who are undergraduate, they are not eligible to apply for Marie Curie Fellowship. Those who did the master, and those who after their masters did not work for more than 4 years, they are eligible to apply for PhD position. So we call them as early stage researcher, ESR. And those who already did their PhD and are involved in some kind of research or some kind of industrial exposure, then they can apply for experienced researcher. We call them as ER. And then we have highly experienced researchers. So it is basically in terms of it supports from PhD to and then I have given another link, which is this link, the second link. In this link you can find every information regarding this Marie Curie Fellowship. So now at the bottom of the slide you see there is a picture which says that supported by Marie Sklodowska-Curie Actions Research Fellowships. This is a clip from the main page of Marie Curie Action. So here you can see, you can find all the vacancies, that is all the research position, by filtering jobs with the means of country and the field. So you can choose a country where you want to apply for PhD, apply for postdoc, apply for highly experienced researcher, and also the field. So you, while filtering your criteria, all the jobs, all the vacancies, all the research positions presently open at that time will be visible to you. So so if you have any question regarding the presentation or regarding higher studies in Europe or any related matter, then please type your question in the comments and I will be happy to answer if I know, if I have the proper knowledge. So talking about the Marie Curie Fellowship in continuation, Marie Curie Fellowship is divided into 4 categories. So we have ITN. So you can see it's called Innovative Training Network, and this Innovative Training Network, I belong to this Innovative Training Network. In this Innovative Training Network, actually many universities and the industry, they come together, they form a pool, they form a community, and they write a proposal together. And after writing the proposal related to some project which can impact the society, for example, my project that deals with the renewable energy. So after writing the proposal, they divide the work into different categories. We call it as work package. And then they decide about how many researchers are going to hire for their work packages. So what does it offer? Surely it offers a very high quality of research, training, and the development of skills that can be done through intra-European travel or international travel or traveling abroad or attending some workshops, some tutorials, some lectures, some soft skill development, some software skill development or hardware skill development that you might need in order to in order to complete your project, in order to complete your research, your PhD, you can do it. And who are eligible to apply? So as I already told, that academic as well as a non-academic sectors they can come together and they can apply for this funding scheme. As a researcher, researchers at doctoral level, so less than 4 years of full-time research experience. So we have, as I told, that we have early stage researcher and experienced researcher. So those who completed their master but did not work for more than 4 years, so they are eligible to apply for the PhD position in any of the European university. And those who already did the PhD, they are eligible to apply for postdoc. So the budget, each year the European Union, they update their budget, and then they send the budgetary amount and allocate them to the different projects. So for some year it was 370 million euros. So you can imagine the amount of money that is involved. Similarly, we have another part of Marie Curie Fellowship which is called as individual fellowship. Individual fellowship is actually, it talks about those researchers who already did their PhD, doctorate, and they wanted to apply, or they want to apply for postdoc, then they can write a proposal in coordination with the host university. So the PhD researcher or the postdoc researcher, he can choose any university, and then he can talk to his supervisor, and both of them can write the proposal and submit it to the European Union. So this is individual fellowship is applicable to those who already did their PhD. Then we have RISE, which is a Research and Innovation Staff Exchange. In this Research and Innovation Staff Exchange, even the staff members of some university, they can come together and they can start mobility, and they can travel to some universities to do their research, and they can collaborate with a different university. So it's basically a kind of a mobility program where the staff members, they can go and visit some academic university, and they can do their research in coordination and collaboration with some other European universities. And then we have COFUN, which is a regional and national as well as international program. It is for both researchers at doctoral and postdoctoral level. So I belong to the ITN, which is an innovative training network, and the project name is Multi-Terminal DC Grid for Offshore Wind. And this project deals with the renewable energy, and the project is funded for, I have another question, and I will surely answer your question. This project, the Innovative Training Network, is actually funded for 3 years. So for the entire 3 years, the European Union gives you the money regarding your living allowance, your social security, your mobility allowance, your family allowance, if you have a family, if you're married, then the research cost, which is a separate one. For example, if you want to go to conference, if you wish to attend a workshop, if you stress upon some lectures, if you want to buy any software, if you want to get some training skills, some skill development related training, then you can ask for the money from the project, and the project will surely fund you, and with the consent that conference, workshop, lecture, and all those research related thing is actually beneficial for the project. So I was funded for 3 years in the Innovative Training Network, and this Innovative Training Network actually consisted of 5 universities and 6 industries across all Europe and China, one from China. And we were doing research in the field of high voltage DC grid and in connection with the offshore wind platform. Then we have individual fellowship. Individual fellowship is actually given for 2 years, 2 to 3 years. It depends upon the global individual fellowship or for the local individual fellowship. In this MSCA, this Marie Sklodowska-Curie Action, actually when a researcher is selected, then he is not selected as a student, but he is selected as an employee of that university or that organization or that company or that SME. So he will work as an employee. That means that an employee in Europe has an employment contract. So you're all 3 years of ITN or 2 years of individual fellowship or 2 or 3 years of COPON will be counted as an experience, because you will have an employment contract. And it's similar with me. I had an employment contract with the university where I belong. So my university, University of Porto, is actually involved in this Marie Curie funding program, and I am the employee of Marie Sklodowska-Curie Actions of University of Porto. Then the European Union covers your monthly living allowance, and it depends upon the country. So in Europe we have countries like Denmark, like UK, which are costlier, and countries like Spain, Italy, Portugal, and some other Baltic countries are less costlier. So depending upon the country, the living allowance is actually decided, and that is decided by the country factor. Then it covers also the social security. So when you are working as an early stage researcher doing your PhD in any university of Europe, in any organization, in any company of Europe, for example, in my project, the companies involved are Alstom, now it has become GE, then it was one SME from Spain, another company from Portugal, which is FSF, then another company in UK, and the next company was in China. So if you are hired as a researcher in Marie Curie Action, then you will be covered with the social security, and that will cover your medical expenses and many more things. Then you will be given the mobility allowance, since you have to travel 30% of your time as a Marie Curie researcher. You have to spend out of your home institution doing your internship, doing your training, doing your workshop, attending your workshop, enhancing your skills. So European Union also provides you mobility allowance. Then the European Union also provides family allowance. And the family allowance is quite helpful to those who are married. So for example, if you have a wife and children, then the European Union will also take care of your family, and they will provide you family allowance for that. And as I also mentioned, that you have research costs associated, that is also provided by the Marie Curie Actions and the EU. Then I have also given another link, which is at the bottom of this page, where you can go and you can find everything about all those programs of Marie Curie, which are Innovative Training Network, Individual Fellowship, RISE, OPEND, and their detailed instructions.